All we have to do is pick up.
Yeah. I got a little time to put it on. That's too big. That's too big.
ourselves on where footwear comes from, how it's made, and shifting the label from using predominantly virgin resources, so buying new fabrics that are made brand new, to developing it so it's using a majority of non-virgin resources, so fabrics which are already in existence that are potentially going to waste. So trying to use design as a useful tool, a tool that's using up, you know, resources that aren't being used, where the water and energy and the carbon that have gone into making them is just going to waste. We're trying to learn and adapt and alter our practices in order to fit into the current times we live in, the current knowledge that we have about, you know, how little water we will have in the future and how scarce resources will be in worst case scenario with climate emergency. So that's what we've been doing.
How do you use your waste? Talk to me about that, because when I think of waste, what do we think of? Bits of fabric that are left on the carpet, even the fibres?
Yes, so just sort of the off cuts and all those little tiny bits. And within our own studio, we've worked for a number of years of kind of keeping those things, because I've never felt satisfied or haven't managed yet to find anywhere good that I can send them where I'm going to be used. So we've worked with the schools and universities that reuse those in art departments. We've worked with organisations who are working with refugees who'd like to make their own clothes, who obviously want to take larger amounts of fabric. And then obviously we try and use those things within our own work, within our handmade textiles. So trying to basically scoop up all the waste that we've created and re-look at it as a resource that we can put into our new work. Which obviously we get a certain amount done in that way, but it's not a whole lot, but that's the rest of that we keep, and we are continuing to look for places and things that we can do with that offcut, and also sort of developing our pattern cutting techniques in the first place to reduce the amount of waste that are produced in that way. So making sure pattern pieces are basically the negative shapes that you cut out in order to make a garment, you know, that they're all fitting edge to edge to reduce the waste in the first place. But then also sort of trying to encourage people that are buying our pieces to return them to us if they need to be repaired, so that they can continue their life as they go on. So there's a lot of areas to be working on, really.
Fashion is a competitive industry, but the idea of sharing normally for collection is kept under wraps.
Yes.
You don't see anything until the catwalk show, and then it is always, you know, sort of a niche group that got invited to look at it. Now you're saying, no, I'm going to share my resources. And earlier this year, what you did, you invited other designers to your studio, didn't you? How did that go?
It was really great, actually. Well, I think it's something that I've realised that we can't do alone. I mean, me learning these things, or my team learning these things, and us putting solutions into place is entirely futile if we're not doing it together. If we're doing it alone, it becomes a futile exercise. So yeah, it was definitely a case of bringing in other designers to the studio and saying, it's taken us months and months to find this packaging. Would you like the contact? Would you like to use it as well? And then realising that actually, lots of other studios in London were also trying to work on this, but we were working on it in separate spaces, entirely unconnected, and that's not an efficient use of time. So when I started trying to work out where to begin with changing what I was doing, I sort of sat down and just wished I could be, I don't know, a fly on the wall inside the Stella McCartney sustainability studio or something, like where I could just absorb the information, because I literally just had no idea where to start.
What about ringing her or sending her a note? Did you have you met Stella?
I've never met her, but I really, I'm sure I'd have so much to
Stella, if you're listening. I'm sure she would, but she's done so much. I mean, she's been doing this since 2001. You started your label in 2011, and yes, come on, let's start that collaboration. We can say we started it here. Are the fabrics accessories that you would never use?
Yes.
So tell me what they are.
I've taken an active step away from any virgin polyester, acetate, acrylic, anything that is made from crude oil, we've stepped away from, and we won't be using in future work. We've also stepped away from using zips.
Oh really? Why is it?
Well, just because, you know, there's a lot of chemicals that go into the manufacturing of anything metal, the stuff is not new stuff, it's just that we've sort of forgotten it or we haven't valued it. I had a very glamorous grandmother, she was absolutely dedicated to the high street. She wore lots of beautiful Marks and Spencer things and Jaeger things, and she always looked incredible. And when she died, you know, I remember going to sort of help sort out her things and being so shocked about how little she had in her wardrobe. She had such few clothes, but they were so perfectly kept and beautifully mended and really valued and worn with such style, even though she didn't have endless wardrobes. And I think there definitely is something to be said for doing things the way we used to do them. We really valued and treasured a very beautiful coat, and we repaired it, we looked after it, we cleaned it properly, and it came back, you know, winter after winter. Yeah, it's definitely a case of looking back as well as looking forward for these new ways to be making and caring and buying and enjoying fashion.
Thank you, Phoebe English. And Stella McCartney, if you're listening, I know a designer would love to be a flower. Come on, guys, reach out to each other. It's all about collaboration. And I have some more emails on that first piece of furniture that you bought. And okay, I might have to kind of rewind, because an MFI three-door chest has absolutely stood the test of time. This is Susan Malarkey, who bought this for her teenage bedroom in the early 70s from MFI. And it's now been with us in Switzerland for over 20 years, and I intend to hang on to it because it's really solid and still looks good enough in the study as a useful repository for our files. Well, it does indeed. Thank you for that, Susan. Mary, further to your programme, I attach a photo of the first piece of furniture. We bought a pair of these